Now, this is a tracker company. Once I invested in a company called Morgan Solar, which was a CPV, concentrated photovoltaic. Instead of lens, they had internal reflection. So they used to collect the rays, bring to center, and redirect. This was an innovation, and I thought it's a brilliant one made of plastic, but it worked only with double axis tracker. So failure came on double axis tracker. So we have an axis tracker expert, please, welcome.
Yeah. So my name is Mantha. So actually I'm known as Mantha in the industry. So maybe I'm taking, since I'm also different on the platform here, everybody else is a module manufacturer. I'm the only guy who is different here. And I would like to touch a bit on the yesterday. I think quite a few were there yesterday, are also here today. And the GTM research was talked about, and then none of you, I think, found a smart track in that list. So after I state few facts, maybe you will have to, I leave it to you, the information, whether to depend on the research reports to take a decision. SmartTrak is a 7-year-old company, and we have commissioned 275 megawatts as of now, and in 75 sites. So if you look at it, yesterday they talked about 1.45 gigawatt as a tracker installation size. I think we are 20% if you look at the size of the tracker industry today. And in terms of the number of sites, maybe the balance all put together will be 75 sites in my opinion. So, and now capability of the tracker I would talk about now. And see, we are the first one to achieve the barrier of 2 lakhs, I don't know. In solar industry, even I was surprised when I looked at the results. So we have crossed the 2 lakh barrier per megawatt achievement in terms of million number of units. I don't know how many of you are developers here, are the EPC companies. I would like to listen to that. So first time I've seen it happening, 2 lakh units. And in terms of capability, in a given day, the tracker technology has produced 33% PLF, which is again, is going to be new in the industry. And in a month, an average 29% PLF has been achieved. It's a sine curve distribution. So, and in a year, close to 23% is the PLF achieved. This is all achieved using the smart track technology. And now, if you look at it, my role at smart track, so I don't sell much of smart track. My job is to ensure that they achieve the growth, double their growth, or triple their growth. So I play an active role there to improve their efficiencies at each of those divisions. The first challenge that we have looked at is that even the civil division is an independent SBU. We offer services to the other tracker manufacturers as solution, the civil solutions. And we have also now looked at, we are a specialist in now, yesterday they coined the word manual tracker. We are also specialist in manual tracker. So I've introduced that concept of manual tracking, and maybe we will also do fixed tracker. I'm known doing things differently. And the other challenge that which was given up by the tracker companies in India is that a terrain which is 90 feet from one end to the other feet with different undulations, we have installed a tracker installation in less than 3 months' time. So terrain which is 90 feet difference from one end to the other end, and with the different undulations, you can imagine a mountain, typically a mountain, a tracker installation is done there, which is less than 30 days' time. So this is in terms of, okay, I had to talk more about this because yesterday DGM research didn't cover smart track. And now in terms of the tracker technology, if you look at it, it's very simple. You put the pedestal, there's no difference between the fixer or any other structure. You put the pedestal, you put the bearing assembly, you put the bearings, then the torque the tubes, and you put the hat section and the modular. And yesterday, they introduced the decentralized and centralized the concept. In a decentralized, you don't use the drive strut and then drive plus assemblies. And in the centralized, you use that. This is the simple technology. And smart track, I make in India, I think all of you developers should give the first right of refusal to the Indian companies before you buy anything from outside. I think 16 installations I've done from 1 megawatt to 2 megawatt to 5 to 20 and 25 megawatt in the country. So I come with, this is my 10th year in the solar industry after having spent more than 2 decades plus in the IT industry. So with that kind of a thing, so you should give the first right of refusal. I will tell you why. Now, Smartrack in the 7 years, they manufactured almost everything in India except the motor and the component that go into electrical assembly, PCB. The rest of all is done by Smartrack. They manufacture actuators, they manufacture the controllers, they manufacture the bearings, and constantly innovating and evolving over a period of 7 years. And then we are the one to introduce the spherical bearing. So in a terrain where you need to have 3 to 5 degree undulations and adopt it, so spherical bearings can take care of that. So you don't need to worry about leveling that point of time. So this is simply in terms of the technology. So yesterday discussion came out between the fixer and then the tracker. So I still leave it to the, because our job as a salesman to give the information so and help you buy. We don't believe in selling. That's my philosophy of sales. Okay, and in this scenario, yesterday I think Puneet talked about GenSol very clearly, which I would say that it's a sine curve distribution generation. And in a peak hour, 1 megawatt inverter at 98% efficiency, majority of them around that, cannot pump more than that, 0.98. So peak hour can be 1 hour, 1.5 hours, or 50 minutes, whatever it may be. I'm not getting into the details. It cannot pump. So what you're trying to, okay, flatten the sine curve. And then so that at every hour you want that 980 kilowatt of pumping should go in. So what happens, okay, generation is during the peak time. So yesterday you talked about, I don't know, module manufacturers will have to comment on that. What happens to the extra generation that is done during peak time? Where is it going, generation? So the module can talk about it. The second thing is inverter guys will have to talk about, can you run an electronic product or an automobile product consistently for 6 hours non-stop at 98% efficiency? What will happen to that product? You are doing a 1.5, 1.6, 1.5 AC-DC ratio. So you want to put that curve to flat. That means inverter has to run for 6 hours continuously at full capacity. Can a car run, automobile car? You will stop it after 2 hours or 3 hours. So this is the information. I'm leaving it between the fixer and the tracker. As a tracker technology, I talked about the performance and the numbers before you. And I'm now giving the where unknown territory. I don't know, frankly. I'm not that technologist to talk about inverter and module, whether what happens to the extra generation during that peak time. So what is the damage that will happen to your system? So I leave the information. So that is in terms of XCD, fixed tilt, and then. And then people showed the failures yesterday. Okay, so the structure failures and then different failures, photographs were shown yesterday. And can you pinpoint the responsibility on the 5 stakeholders? Is it a procurement team, the design team, or the EPC team, or the owner himself? Who exactly is responsible for all those failures? Can you pinpoint it? At the end of the day, poor vendor is going to take the blame. I agree. You can't help it, because that is the easier. If you look at the LinkedIn, the posts that have happened, everybody keeps blaming the vendor. But actually, who is responsible? Is the design team responsible? Is the procurement team? Or the owner himself says, no, no, you put 1.6 DC ratio, no problem. I need that numbers, because morning the bank has talked about that numbers. He said, okay, P90, 1.2 DSCR ratio. The only way you can do it, okay, on the PVC's report, you'll have to show that much. Okay, so given that, so who will have to, okay, blame them? And then another point that was talked about yesterday was the punch points. Even after 5 years, the punch point knots are cleared. And if you really look at it, the summary, nobody gives you credit except the 3 guys in the solar industry. The civil guy, the structure guy, to some extent, fixed guys doesn't give you, tracker guys give you, basically because we have control over the tracker. We can stop that from running remote. We can do that, give you a little credit. And the DC guys and the AC guys. This is the only thing lab-driven. So morning they didn't talk about this part, and in 5 years if you don't give the payment to that guy because of punch points, and who is suffering is the labor, because that vendor over the aggregator is not going to pay the labor. He'll say, I have not got the money. So what happens in that scenario? Maybe all the developers were there. The key point that you need to address is that module guy China gets his money 100%, no problem. Okay, the inverter gets 100%. Every other guy gets the 100% except these three vendors. Poor guy and all the punch points because of their problems, and these guys suffered. So what I would say at the end of the day, because nobody gave the approach, everybody talked about the solution. My approach would be is to please collaborate. And solar is a different behavior altogether. I can tell you, when I started in the solar industry, first thing when I also handled the module manufacturing, supply chain. I don't know how many of you have experienced that. If you buy less, you will get a lesser price. This is not the business behavior, conventional business behavior. If you buy more, you will get less. In solar, if you buy less, you will get a lesser price. Those days when you buy the wafer or you wear the cells, they always say that, boss, you take, no, you don't talk about 10 megawatt, I'll give you 500, I'll give you a 2 cents less. This is the behavior of solar. So you need to, because majority of the procurement team, they're coming from the conventional team into this, and they apply the same principles here. So my request will be, please collaborate, having chosen that, a vendor, at the site. Because any site you go and see today, it'll be either a fresher site person, or he will be with one site installation experience, because you will not get a guy to stay there at 48 degrees and 45 degrees and then do installation project. He'll run away after 2 days. Either he becomes sick or he run away. So please collaborate, my sincere request, because this is going to have a huge impact at the O&M at the end of the day. Because a plant which I missed out here consistently for 4 years, because I built that plant as part of my portfolio, consistently has been giving greater than 18% returns using a tracker. Year on year, it's purely because of O&M. The plant was built well and O&M has become easy. Another plant which I talked about is also built by me, because that is the reason I take pride in presenting these numbers of 33, 29 and 23. As part of my earlier portfolio, I built this plant. So it's giving a huge number. So at the end of the day, my message is to, request is to collaborate. Please don't look at as a vendor independently and then behave the way you behave with a vendor. He's your team at the end of the day. Okay, punch points, collectively resolve it. And end of the day, take pains to make that last 10% payment or 5% payment. Because industry is suffering, 2.44 guy is not going to get a civil vendor, in my opinion, if this continues. Because you don't find get a civil vendor at the end of the day. All of them are running away because I don't get my payment. Let's not do solar at all. The risk for 2.44 is large here rather than okay at that. Okay, I calculated two other points which Anand wanted me to address, is that GST and the other one is the 2.44. For a 2.44, the project cost is 2.31 crores. Anybody can calendar me, I have no problem, I'll then clarify to you. Anna, 10% or little buffer also I am saying, or a 25% cent and then 66 conversion ratio of a dollar. Okay, so, and the second thing is for GST, today it's 8 lakhs per megawatt for MNRE exemption. That is the only thing which needs to be addressed first. Because MNRE exemption, if they give, you don't need to worry about GST, we are talking about. The cost for the project is 8 lakhs per megawatt if that excise duty exemption is not passed on. So that is not addressed in GST. So let the GST charge, let MNRE give an exemption, we don't need to worry about. So we need to go to MNRE and cry rather than, okay, morning we talked about, just go to them and then give the same extension, how do you do it? That can come out of the policy direction and then one, and then they will give you certification and all that will follow. So 8 lakhs, and the second thing is in terms of the CST or the VAT that you talk about, majority of them were buying from Bangalore because there's 0% tax there, sales tax. So what happens to that, who are buying that? So if these two are addressed, otherwise I think for a VAT 5% overall solar power generating station, that is being paid even currently also. And that remains the same for the GST, there is no impact there. If you go to an EPC, the only thing is majority of them are not, okay, going the EPC route, they have their own team now. Very less number of people still go for EPC at this point of time. And finally, when you collaborate, my last the point is that it has to be a turnkey approach to you. Your the conventional procurement behavior is to break it till every layer and squeeze the margin of every part. Don't do that. Stop somewhere. Especially when it comes to structure, because I'm going to restrict myself to structure. I don't want to give complete gnan that I have. So when it comes to structure, the civil erection and the structure supply has to be one. Don't break that. Because when combat, why the tracker industry, you should prefer the discipline of a tracker installation is very, very high. Because alignment restrictions are so much that, okay, that takes care of, the discipline takes care of the installation. If you break that up, supply guy will say, I don't know what the civil guy has done. And then erection guy will say, the sagging is there and then bend, I don't know what the erection guy has done there, MMS erection. So my request is, bro, don't break that. Today the industry behavior is that, okay, let me not get into the pain area, which I would like to avoid. That's what I've been promoting at SmartTrack. Let's be a turnkey players. Okay, mini EPC you can call it. So if you break this up, you have no solution at all at the end of the day. The punch points will never get closed. You cannot expect a civil guy to have any punch points. They are maximum cooping and then 150 mm. That's all, nothing more than that. But the work there is going to impact the pedestal alignment and then MMS alignment and then erection of modules. So this I strongly feel that, especially EPC players or whoever it may be, because they would look at, okay, let me take the MMS and then increase some margin there. Let me do the civil myself. You give only the design or you give the electronic components. Okay, the tracker component, that's it. You give your job is that, rest of it will take care. Please don't do that. Let it be an integrated solution and let that person demonstrate the complete capability to you. Otherwise, you are not going to have a solution which is suitable for O&M to take over. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mantha. I was always wondering which kind of manpower gap exists. I think we need contract psychologists also. Because if that's the case, technology married to challenges of punch points, I think that's the only way we can address. Thank you very much. We have a last speaker. We need, you're welcome. Then we'll open it for question answers.
Yeah, good afternoon, everybody. I am Vineet and I represent Insulation Energy Private Limited, based out of Jaipur. We have recently started and with a 60 megawatt of module manufacturing unit. In fact, at the onset, I would like to thank EQ for giving me this opportunity to represent Insulation Energy. And in particular, I am looking for Anand. Actually, all kudos to him for putting me, since I belong to business development, and putting me on dais for technology discussions makes me somewhat uncomfortable. But nevertheless, I'll try to enlighten myself for the benefit of all of you. When we talk of technology, I'll take a slightly different approach. I'll try to link it up with the evolution of mankind and how we have reached to this stage. We started around few lakh years back with leading a nomadic life, hunting animals and earning a livelihood for ourselves. Then somehow later, few thousand years down the line, we started living in a society, started with agriculture and started earning for per se ourselves only. With the new innovations, with the discovery of new alloys, metals, the things started improving and we started with the mass agriculture productions. Later on came the stage where we have industrial evolutions, where factories in European countries and later on to Asian countries, they started producing in masses, for masses in volumes, bringing down the cost. Then in 90s, we have, everybody knows where India is known for its IT revolution, where things getting started automizing. And now a stage has come where beyond this, the only scope which I feel left is of knowledge and being innovative. And there the role of technology comes. So as I discuss, there is no denial of the fact that our society development and progress has been primarily because of technology. And having recently started in this industry per se, because we are into module manufacturing, I have been observing for the last 2 days. In fact, I have been in this industry for the last 7-8 years. Everybody is trying to pass the onus on module manufacturers. We start from the bottom at 2.4. We started with somewhere around 18 rupees. Now, only things what we do is just look at the module manufacturers. Now, my point is, when we talk of technology, how a module manufacturer can achieve this? Are we producing silicon in India? Do we have a master manufacturing facility? We don't have. We start with only processing of cell into wafers into cells. That is also being imported. So to minimize the cost, what is the option left with the module manufacturers in India? Are we doing anything on the technology side? I don't think so. We are merely laying up the cells, soldering, laminating, and putting up the junction box, and finally we are discussing about the prices. Is the government doing anything for the upliftment of the module manufacturers, or maybe putting up of silicon manufacturing or wafer manufacturing in India? Everybody is good enough for talking about the technology, but nobody is seriously putting in efforts or the funds for the upliftment of manufacturing, or maybe the finding new innovative technology for manufacturing side. There is no doubt that everybody is talking about cost optimization, but have anybody talked about the technology optimization? We are happy thinking about robotic cleaning, single axis tracker, double axis tracker, but we are not talking about the manufacturing side. So that is the reason we are not able to do much more things in the innovative ways, or maybe bringing over the cost. So that way, I think we need to have separate funds, especially when we talk about defense sectors. We have DRDO, sir. I think you were there. So government is putting up funds for DRDOs. For we are now having Make in India for defense sectors. We are having our own space program. But is there anything by the name of solar fund? No doubt we have clean energy fund, but that is for providing the subsidy. Nothing has been done till date for finding innovative products or maybe innovative technology for manufacturing. When I talk of manufacturing, there are 2-3 critical factors. There are manufacturing process, there is quality of raw material, and the trained manpower. The raw material, I think most of them is imported from China or maybe from Taiwan. There is hardly any Indian company which is doing much of research into this segment. When we talk about trained manpower, of late we have started with this Power Sector Council or Green Council and Skill India campaign. But it's a good step in a direction, but still, is there any sort of collaboration between the industry and the academia? Are we doing high quality research into this segment? We are merely training people for the installation and commissioning. We don't have defined research institutes specifically dedicated to solar energy. There are 2-3 institutes which are doing, and there is no collaboration between industry. I have seen, I've read also in few countries like Europe, wherein the professors or the leading scientists, they are deputed to the industry for a period of 2 to 3 years. So the, whatever they do at the laboratory level, that is also being replicated at the commercial level also. So that kind of setup is missing in India. Government is setting up funds for providing subsidy, viability gap funding. We are talking of lower rate of interest, but still nothing has been done for talking in terms of technology upliftment. So my point is this concern. Secondly, when we talk of solar for 25 years, no doubt we need to have a quality. As far as I understand, when I go to any of my possible customers, they only talk of, do you have the certificates? I think for most of them, what is more important is, do you have IEC, are you MNRE certified? But nobody talks ki what kind of quality standards you have, what kind of manufacturing practices are you following, can we have a look at your facility? Nobody is thinking of that terms. Maybe because of the pressure of 2.5 is so much on them that we are not talking about the quality. And especially I'm talking in sense for rooftop, where the quality is of utmost importance, where space is a constraint, we need to get more of generation from a limited space. That segment is very unorganized. We have manufacturing facilities which are of 5 to 10 megawatts which are doing it manually. But there are no standards. I am not against anybody, but still we need to have something very robust in place to have a quality check at these things also. So that at the end of the day, when things are produced for 25 years, yes, we can say with surety this is going to last for 25 years. And lastly, when I talk of quality technology, they are much more than just a production or a manufacturing side. What about after 25 years? Do we have the technology for safely disposal of maybe cadmium telluride or maybe the silicons? Nobody is talking of that. Do we have the technology for the safety? When we are putting up the plants of 100 megawatts of size, 500 megawatts of size, nobody is talking of technology or being innovative in safety, security and all. Yesterday, sir, you were talking about the operation and maintenance. When we talk about the people going in for rooftops, for panel cleaning, what kind of technology are we employing this? And when we are talking of megawatts of sizes, there are hardly any quality standards or the safety techniques or maybe the security drills and all which we are following. So the role of technology per se for manufacturing side is different, for safety side is different, security side is different. So I leave it to you or maybe to the government to think from that angle also, so that we can have more funds for the research, we can have more of industry, academia interaction, we have more of trained manpowers, and let us not be just adopters. We are importing things, replicating hairs, and just trying to give them at a very competitive prices without bothering about the economies, without bothering about the innovativeness, without bothering about the technologies. So I wrap up this by saying the technology definitely plays a great role, but we need to put more of efforts, more of sincere actions into this. Thank you.
Thank you, Vineet. Thanks all the speakers. I've been given a deadline of 1:30, which expires in 60 seconds. So being a stickler to deadlines, I gave the mic to Anand. You can conduct question answer if you want, or you can liquidate the session.
Thank you very much, sir. We have actually a schedule to follow. So question answers definitely can be carried out during the networking lunch break. So big round of applause for this session on technology. Thank you very much, sir. I'll request our session chair, Mr. Rajendra to present mementos of appreciation to all the speakers of this session.